people from every nation.
I live.
I love cake. I love sweet potato pie. I love. When you love the Lord, you are sold out. You are sold out. You have committed everything of who you are to Him. You trust. And the circumstances don't look good, right? The situation seems faltering. But you just say, I love you, Lord, more than anything. Because we know who He is, amen? We know who we serve, right? Amen. Right? So you can't do anything but declare that. Amen. So this next song, let's take an opportunity to think about, continue to think about how much we love Him. And realize that the best thing that ever happened to us was when He said, out of all the people, all the people, I choose you. I choose you. I choose you. Just think about that. Out of all that I was doing and all that stuff I was into, not even giving him a thought, he said, it's time for you to come to me, Denise. It's time for you to come to me. So think about that when you sing this song. It's the best thing. Best choice you had ever made was to say, okay, Lord, I surrender. I surrender. It's all about you now. Praise him with this song. Falling in love with Jesus. Praise the Lord. Falling in love with Jesus.
Falling in love with Jesus. Falling in love with Jesus was the best thing I've ever done.
Falling in love. Falling in love.
Falling in love with Jesus. Falling in love with Jesus. Falling in love with Jesus. Jesus was the best thing I've ever done.
thank you, Lord. Thank you so much for drawing us into your presence, Lord. Thank you for calling us out of darkness into your marvelous light. Lord, because falling in love with you was the best thing we've ever done, Lord. And we want to say thank you for bringing us to you. Thank you for loving us and keeping us and caring for us and providing for us in ways that we cannot imagine. Thank you for your protection, Lord, from dangers seen and unseen. Thank you for just giving us family and friends and just loving us, Lord, and showing us how to love others. Lord, right now we just want to say thank you, and we want to lift up the concerns of our hearts, Lord. We thank you that you provide for our daily needs, dear Heavenly Father, food, clothes, and shelter, Lord. We thank you that you provide transportation. We thank you that you provide jobs, Lord. We thank you for all of your provision. We thank you for the friends that you provide for us, dear Heavenly Father, to help us to stay on this narrow way that you pathway that you have for us, Lord. We thank you for your corrective measures that you place in our lives, even though we don't like them at the time, Lord. We thank you for reminding us that you are God, and you are God all by yourself, dear Heavenly Father, and that you love us so much that you will always be in our life. So we thank you, Lord, and we ask that you will always give us ears to hear you, an attitude to follow your will, dear Heavenly Father, and the time to just spend with you like today, Lord. We thank you. We thank you. We thank you. Lord, there's so much going on in our world today, dear Heavenly Father. We just don't know where to start to ask for help at, dear Heavenly Father. So we're saying help us, dear Heavenly Father. Help us to be your hands and feet. Help us to love others as we love ourselves. Help us to show what loving ourselves look like so we can love others as we love ourselves. Help us to remember to always put you first in our lives, dear Heavenly Father, to love you, God. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for giving us the love that we can give back to you to show how much we love you. And thank you for caring for us. Lord, we know about the war in Ukraine, dear Heavenly Father. And sometimes we just get tired of seeing all the death and destruction and stuff. The greed of other people, other countries, the selfishness of wants and needs, dear Heavenly Father, that we will do to get what we want, dear Heavenly Father. So, Lord, we lift up that country, dear Heavenly Father. We lift up Ukraine, Lord, and we also lift up Russia, dear Heavenly Father. And we ask for your intervention, Lord. We ask for your protection for all of the innocent lives, dear Heavenly Father, that are stuck in the middle, dear Heavenly Father, those people who didn't want wars or anything like that. And Lord, we ask for provisions for homes and places to stay for those who are stuck and can't go anywhere, dear Heavenly Father, for those who've lost their homes, who've lost everything, dear Heavenly Father. We just ask that you would intervene and provide, dear Heavenly Father. Lord, and also right here in America, we still have hungry kids. I am so amazed that we still have children who are hungry right here in the United States with all the wealth we have, dear Heavenly Father. Move on the hearts of your people, dear Heavenly Father. Move on the hearts of your people to provide meals, clothing, and shelter. Lord, help us to be generous to others the way you are generous to ourselves, dear Heavenly Father. Lord, we thank you for just providing for us and making it available for us to provide for others. Lord, we thank you for South Bay and all that you're doing in this body of believers, dear Heavenly Father. We thank you for our leadership, dear Heavenly Father. We thank you for every part of this service that makes it worship service to you, dear Heavenly Father. And we ask that you would bless our speaker today. Be with them as they speak, dear Heavenly Father, and that you would open our ears to hear what they have to say, dear Heavenly Father, and that it would provide strength and nourishment and encouragement to go out and continue doing your will. We thank you for this day, Lord, and we thank you for your love. We thank you for your care for us. We thank you for your mercy. We thank you for you, Lord, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We thank you for being our God, and we thank you for calling us to be your people. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen.
Jesus.
Nice to see you all living on each other. Let's come back to the Lord in worship. For those of you on Zoom, they are having a good time here today. So when the mood hits you, right, to come on down and join us. Got kids running around. What a blessing. What a blessing. Amen. It is good to see you all again. All the love in the room. The room is filled with the Holy Spirit and love. I love that. Give God a hand clap. At this time, I want to encourage you to let God know how much you appreciate all the things he is doing for you. And give back to the Lord. We have several ways you can give. We have the app. We have the website. We have regular mail, whichever way works for you. But let God know how much you appreciate what he does for you and all the blessings and your health and all the things that he has continued to bless us with. Let me pray for our offering this morning. Father God, we're just so grateful that you have given us another day to be in your presence, to be with family, to be with friends, to hug, to love on each other, and just open our hearts to give freely and willingly and eager to give to you and say thank you for all the things you do. In your precious name we pray, amen. Amen.
Tragedies are commonplace, all kinds of diseases, people are slipping away. Folks without homes are in the streets, and the drug habits, some say, they just can't be. Muggers and robbers, no place seems to be safe. Would you be my protection every step of the way? And I won't say, thank you, Lord, for all you've done for me.
South Bay family, these are your highlights and announcements for the week. Join us next week for our special Mother's Day service on May 14th at 10:30 a.m. live and on Zoom. Our theme for the day is Pearls of Wisdom, and we can't wait to share some of the unique insights from our South Bay mothers on topics such as motherhood, parenting, and even gems they've learned from their mothers. Adding to the celebration, Lita Wong of Restore 22 and formerly of SBCC will bring the Word of God as our guest speaker. We'd love to see you in person for this celebratory service, but we respect your freedom of choice if you decide to participate in our virtual experience. Let's celebrate mothers, grandmothers, great-grandmothers, mother figures, and mothers-to-be while worshiping God together.
Growing up, it was always kind of a mystery about my dad and his side of the family. Whenever my brother and I would ask him about my grandfather, he would just say, oh, it's a sad story, it's not a big deal. One day we came across this photo of a gravestone, and that's when my dad finally told us that this is where my grandfather and great-grandfather were buried. But not in China, in Mississippi.
Chinese people in Mississippi? What happened there?
I actually don't know where we're going and where we're going.
Last thing I thought I'd ever find in Mississippi was a Chinese museum.
I guess there was more than just my grandfather and my great-grandfather.
When the Chinese first came to the Delta, they were treated like we were.
Everything was very segregated. I mean, it was black, white. We were just really in the middle.
I had to attend a segregated one-room schoolhouse.
Growing up, I read about segregation, and I thought that it only affected the black community.
I just didn't really think that it happened to the Chinese, too.
What?
Great-grandpa!
Oh, my God!
I knew all your family.
It is so important for people to know what happened with the Chinese Exclusion Act and how it affected Chinese Americans throughout the nation, including the South.
Mark your calendars for a unique opportunity to learn more about an often overlooked part of American history. On Sunday, May 21st at 2 p.m., we're screening the documentary Far East, Deep South, which tells the story of a Chinese-American family exploring their roots in the Mississippi Delta. The film is followed by a discussion and Q&A with its producer, Baldwin Chu. Don't miss out on this fantastic event. Join us at the church for an afternoon of history, race, and culture. It's time for our quarterly vision casting meeting, church family, so be sure to stick around after service or on Zoom. During the meeting, we'll get an update on financials and other matters as part of the church vision. Let's hear what's next as part of God's business. These are your highlights for the week.
This is for somebody who may have wanted to give up. I know someone who you can trust, and he'll never let you down. God is saying this: I will be with you. In your trouble, God says, I will be with you. In your heartache, God says, I will be with you. If you will only trust me, God is saying, trust me. He says, I'm your father, trust me. He also will say, I'll never leave you. Friends may walk away, family may turn away, but God says, I got your back. I'll never leave you. In your darkest hour, God says, I'll never leave you. If you will only trust me. God says, trust me. He says, I'm all that you need. Trust me. Not only that, but he said, I'll fight your battle. Stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. For the battle is not yours, but it's God's. Don't try to fight the battle yourself. Let God do it. your heartache.
Trust me.
In your sadness. Listen, God is saying, I am.
I am.
He says that I am.
That I am.
And I have all power.
I have all power.
I don't care what you find yourself in. I will deliver you every time. You will only trust me. Says I'm God all by myself.
Trust me.
Just trust me.
Trust me.
This is what he's saying today.
I am.
That I am. God says I have
my
power. Oh, yes, I do.
Trust me.
That's what he's saying.
Trust me.
Yes, he does.
Hallelujah.
Trust me.
Trust me.
He says I'm Alpha and Omega.
Trust me.
The beginning and the end.
Trust me.
If you put your trust in me.
Trust me.
And even in the midst of recession, Lord,
trust me.
God says I own the cattle on a thousand hills. And I'm able to take care of you. Yes, I will.
That's a hard one, isn't it?
Yes.
I've been listening to that song over and over. It just gripped me, and I realize, I don't know, maybe I'm the only one. But trust is hard. Especially when we are in dark places. So I invite you, family, find that song, put it in your toolkit for those times when you are finding it hard, because it is that simple and it is that hard at the same time. It's as simple as God says, if you will only trust me. But that's hard. Amen. Well, brothers and sisters, as we continue, we are in our series, The Gift of Darkness. And we have been exploring the truth that God says that darkness and light are the same to him, that he is present. There's nowhere we can go and be outside of his presence. But sometimes it is so dark that we can't see him, we can't feel him. You know those back country roads where they don't have street lights and your hand can be right here and you can't see it? Sometimes that's what it feels like when we're in those seasons of darkness. And in those seasons, God says, I am right here. I am just as close as I've ever been. All you have to do is trust me. Well, as we begin this morning, I'm going to invite you to do something with me first. We'll get to our text in a moment, but I want you first to put one hand over your heart. And that represents the closeness of God. And I want you to put the other hand on your belly.
And now I want you just to take a deep, deep breath in so that you feel your belly expand. Breathe in slowly and expand your belly as far as you can go, and then blow it out with your mouth, gently, like you're blowing out a candle. Feel your belly deflate. Breathe in again through your nose. Breathe out through your mouth. Do that a few more times, and it's interesting because we're told that we take about 8 million breaths a year, but most of them are not deep breathing. And we really need to do it more often because there are so many benefits to deep breathing that God has provided for us. We're told that deep breathing helps with anxiety. It helps with depression. It helps us in managing stress. It improves our focus, gives us better sleep. And after exercise or exertion, it helps us recover faster. So go ahead and take one more deep breath and thank God for the wonderful gift of oxygen. I'm reminded of that song that we sometimes sing in praise and worship, that you are the air I breathe. When you take in that deep breath, think of the breath of God, the Holy Spirit, that is living and abiding with us. So why did I want to start? You can put your hands down or you can keep breathing. Deep breathing, you got to keep breathing. But why did I want to start with breathing this morning? Two reasons. First is it is Mental Health Awareness Month, and we all know about the mental health epidemic in our country, probably in the world. We've been through a lot. And deep breathing is one of the best tools, the best practices, the best exercises that God has given us for caring for our mental health. And when you add that deep breathing to a breath prayer, you have brought God into your consciousness. You've brought God into your breathing experience. And second, as we go to God's word this morning, we will be talking about the gift of darkness and trauma. The gift of darkness and trauma. And so I recognize that for some of you, this may be a challenging message. So I wanted to start with that practice, because if any time during my message this morning, if you're feeling some anxiety or if your mind is going to places and you find yourself starting to feel triggered, I want you just encouraged to remember God is with you and take a deep breath, the very breath of God, and let the Holy Spirit comfort you and fill you with his peace. In fact, let's continue our breathing practice as we go to our scripture text this morning. We're going to treat it as a breath prayer. There'll be a prompt on the screen so you'll be able to follow along. I will read the scripture and I'll have you inhale and exhale as I read the text. Hear the word of the Lord as we breathe deeply. Inhale. He heals the brokenhearted. Exhale, and bandages their wounds. Inhale. He counts the stars. Exhale, and calls them by name. Inhale. How great is our Lord. Exhale. His power is absolute. in hell. His understanding exhale is beyond comprehension. Heavenly Father, as we come to your word this morning, Lord, we have had such a sweet time in your presence and worshiping you, Lord. We've been reminded of how much we love you and how loving you is the best thing we've ever done. Lord, we've come to you in prayer and we have petitioned and brought our requests before you. Heavenly Father, we have fellowshipped and greeted one another and expressed our love and in hugs and kind words, and those online were able to greet one another and just feel the warmth and the love of your sons and your daughters. Lord, we've paused for a moment and expressed our gratitude to you with our tithes and our offerings and have entrusted them into your care for the advancement of your kingdom. And Lord, right now we come to your word. Lord, we want to continue our worship and now hear what it is that you want to say to us. Lord, I ask that you would guide this message, you would guide our thoughts, that you would open our ears and our hearts to hear exactly what you have for each one of us. Because Lord, it is not an accident that we are gathered together today. You want to speak to us. May we hear you, and may we be faithful to respond. Hear our prayer this morning. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Well, family, when I was about 7 or 8 years old, my family, we lived in this little town. I want to call it like a little hamlet in New York State. It was called Hillburn. And it couldn't have had more than 1,000 people. It was a small little place. It was butted up against a mountain on one side. And in my memory, and I believe this is true, there's only 3 ways to get in and get out. 2 of them was right off of Highway 17, and 1 was across a bridge that took you to another town. And it was a tiny little, I want to call it a village, felt like a village. I looked up the population. I was curious of what was the population in the 60s. And the farthest I could go back was the 90s. And in the 90s, there was only 900 people there. And now in 2023, there's only 1,100. So it is a tiny little place. And we lived there, and it was segregated in that time. It was there was a definite street, and everybody knew it was how it was, that on one side of the street was where most of the white people lived, and on the other side of this street is where most of the black people lived, and you didn't think nothing of it, it's just how it was. But the school was integrated, one tiny little school, and so everybody went to the school until they bussed all of us out of there when I was in the 4th grade and the school closed down. But I must have been in about 2nd grade, and those were in the days where you could actually walk to your friend's house and your parents wouldn't mind. It was about 4 to 6 blocks away. So I was walking to my friend's house, and my friend lived on that dividing street. She was white. She was one of my closest friends at that time. She was a PK also. So we had a lot in common. We would hang out a lot. And so we would be at each other's houses. And so on this particular day, I was walking to her house, and right when I got to the corner of that street and was about to cross over to go to her house, I passed a house that was on my left, and I can still see this girl coming from her yard. Her yard was kind of elevated, so she was coming from her yard and came down onto the sidewalk and punched me in the back. And it's weird because I don't remember anything else after that. I don't know if I fought her, probably not, knowing my personality. I wasn't the fighting kind back then. Don't mess with me now. <All right. laughs> But I probably didn't fight her back. I don't remember if I cried. I don't remember if I kept going to my friend's house. I don't remember if I turned around and went home. I don't remember much anything else. But I do remember that punch. And I do remember that it hurt. And I now know that that was a traumatic experience. I didn't have the language for it then, and I didn't really think about it because it wasn't really a big deal as an adult. But it was a trauma nonetheless. The truth is that everyone has a trauma history. We may have what we consider the big T trauma, something that's life-threatening or that has shaken our integrity or domestic violence or abuse or a natural disaster or an accident. Most of you know that in 2020, I got hit by a car, and to this day, I pause extra long before I cross the street. It's automatic. And if I'm crossing and I see a car that doesn't look like it's slowing down, I back up, even if there's a stop sign. I've been forever changed by that. Or perhaps you would have something that you feel, well, that's not really a big deal. Should I even call it a trauma? And those might be called small T traumas, like the girl that came and punched me in the back. Doesn't really seem that bad. We may not want to even call it a trauma. But mental health professionals say that we experience much more trauma than we typically recognize and typically report. We can even experience secondary and tertiary trauma when we witness something or see something that unsettles us. That's why you may have noticed more and more on TV, they will give what they call trigger alerts, because we can be watching something and it can trigger a memory, a trauma for us. We can even hear someone's traumatic story and be impacted by their story, even though it's not happening to us. We can experience collective trauma, and we all know what that's like because we all experienced the trauma of COVID together. We experienced the trauma of George Floyd's murder together. Friends, the more we become aware and are able to process our traumas, the healthier we will be. But first, we must recognize it and name it as such. Otherwise, it can linger as a darkness, a wound that resides within and can impact us in ways we aren't even aware that we are being impacted. From our body's viewpoint, all trauma is physical as well as emotional. It starts with an event that triggers the fight, flight, freeze, or fawn response. During one of these life-threatening events or an integrity-threatening event or something that frightens us, our bodies can interpret that we are being traumatized even before we are aware of what's happening. Our bodies go into action. Fear races up the spinal cord and activates a complex system of brain signals that helps us respond automatically like animals who are being threatened, because that's what we're feeling in that moment. And so we automatically are posed to fight, to flee, to freeze. Or the newest one that they've been adding is fawn, which is people-pleasing and trying to make it all better. Sometimes we learn about past traumatic experiences not by trying to access our memories, but by paying attention to what's happening in our bodies. If we are experiencing cold and sweaty hands, or we're noticing that our pulse is increasing, or we have feelings of anxiety, or stomach issues, or our voice is at a higher pitch, or we are feeling bodily tremors, these are all physical responses of a threat that can live on in our bodies and can be triggered. Trauma impacts our relationships, our communication, our sense of wellness and health. Trauma can be the lens by which we see the world. And we can't always know that that's what's happening. And of course, we know that the darkness of trauma can challenge our faith with questions like, well, where was God? Where is God? How could God allow this to happen? Where is the love of a supposedly loving father? When we have trauma, it can rock our world. These are hard questions when we are suffering and in pain, when we are limping and broken and groping in the darkness, when we are frightened and feeling out of control and unsafe. It's hard to remember that God is by your side. It's hard to feel God's peace when you're in shock. One of the more recent biblical interpretations, perspectives that biblical scholars have been wrestling with these days is reading the Bible through a lens of trauma. There is all kinds of trauma in the Bible. Just as the areas of psychology and mental health have dived deeper into trauma and trauma recovery and trauma-informed care, theologians have done the same with a deeper dive to look at the Bible through a trauma lens as well. And such a lens helps us to read Scripture with fresh insight and fresh understanding. We see a God that's relevant and relatable to our realities. If you attended Sunday school or VBS, you probably know the story of the teenage boy with the coat of many colors. What's his name, everybody? Joseph. Joseph is a story in Genesis that is often told like this.
Part of God's story is about a guy named Joseph, and it begins like this. Once there was a guy named Joseph who had 10 older brothers and one younger one. When Joe was a boy, he was his dad's favorite. In fact, his dad liked him so much better than his brothers that he gave Joe a special gift to prove it. You can imagine this made his brothers jealous. And Joe only made things worse. He told his brothers about dreams he had where he was ruling over them. Well, this made Joe's brothers furious. One day they were working and saw Joe coming. They said, "Here comes that dreamer." They threw Joe into a dark pit. They might have left him there forever, but they met some men traveling from Egypt and sold Joe to them as a servant instead. They thought that was slightly nicer than leaving him in a pit. Then they went home and told their father Joe had been killed by a wild animal. This broke their dad's heart. Kids, these brothers were really bad news. Selling a sibling is never a good idea, ever. But the Bible says the Lord was with Joe. When Joe was a servant, he worked for a really important rich guy named Potiphar. And Potiphar liked Joe so much, he put him in charge of the whole house. Joe was happy until one day he was blamed for something he didn't do, and Potiphar sent him straight to jail. Well, God was still with Joe, even in prison. The guard decided he liked Joe so much, he put him in charge of all the other prisoners. Then God gave Joe special knowledge about dreams. When two prisoners had dreams, Joe knew what they meant. So he told them. 2 years later, Egypt's ruler called Pharaoh had a dream, and nobody knew what it meant. But by now, one of the two prisoners Joe had helped was out of jail and working for Pharaoh. He told Pharaoh about Joe, and God helped Joe figure out what Pharaoh's dream meant. But Pharaoh's dream was really more of a nightmare. It meant that everybody in Egypt would have food for 7 years, then be hungry for 7 years. Joe told Pharaoh the only way to survive was to store food during the 7 good years. Well, Pharaoh thought Joe's idea was brilliant. He put him in charge. During the 7 hungry years, nobody could eat without getting food from Joe. He was like a human vending machine. Well, remember how Joe had 11 brothers? Like everybody else, they had to get food from Joe. And when they came, they didn't even recognize their brother. But Joe knew who they were. He secretly tested them to see if they changed. After all, they did throw him in a pit and sell him. Finally, he couldn't hide who he was from his brothers anymore. He told everyone to leave the room because he was about to cry. After sobbing for a few minutes, he told them, "I'm your brother Joseph. I'm the one you sold." The brothers couldn't believe it. They had hurt Joe, but God had taken care of him during the good times and the bad. Even with everything they had done to Joe, he forgave them because he was willing to follow God, even when it was hard. Joe told them, "You planned to harm me, but God planned it for good." And God used Joe to save many lives, including the family that was part of God's special rescue plan. And that's the story of Joseph.
Family, that was, of course, written for kids, so it's a simplified version. But there's so much more to the story, which is why it is important that we keep reading our Bibles, because sometimes we have a Sunday school version in our heads, and we think we know the story. We need to go back and see what is that story with adult eyes. But even as adult, Joseph's story is sometimes told like a fairy tale. It's presented as a from pit to palace, from rags to riches kind of story. He's often portrayed as an arrogant teenager who enraged his brothers with his dreams. It's noted how he became a leader wherever he was placed once he got to Egypt. They always point out how he resisted temptation and did not succumb to adultery. How even when he was wrongfully accused and unjustly punished, he was faithful to God. How he manifested God-given insights in his dream interpretation and God-given wisdom in his administrative gifts. And how he returned evil for good when his brothers came in time of need. There is a lot we can learn from Joseph's strength of character and his behaviors. That's true. And I don't want to deny the things we typically focus on for Joseph. Those are positive things. But there's also a lot we can learn from Joseph's brokenness, from his trauma journey to healing, and how God was with Joseph in the darkness. Time doesn't allow me to go deep into Joseph's story. That little video we saw spans Genesis 37 to Genesis 50. But I want to briefly look at Joseph's story through the lens of trauma. Because Joseph's journey to recovery and healing is our journey too. It's the way that we can see God at work in our healing, how God redeems trauma as a gift in the darkness. But first, we need to be real and name that Joseph experienced trauma. We can't pass that too quickly. There was a premeditated plot to murder him. Hold that for a minute. And although the plan changed, he was physically attacked, stripped of his robe, and thrown into what the Bible says was a waterless cistern. That means it had a drop to it, and there was nothing in the bottom to break the fall. Think about that. On the same day, he was sold into slavery. Talk about trauma. And this was done by his brothers, his family, by those who were supposed to be, he could trust them. I contend that the most painful of betrayals and traumas is the wounds by those that we trust. You know, with this lens of trauma, I saw something different in Joseph's story that I hadn't really noticed before. Have you ever noticed how sometimes the way we tell this story of Joseph, it appears that Joseph is the one at fault? It's like if you didn't tell them and brag about your dreams, yes, yes, this wouldn't have happened to you. Yes. And that can be true of our trauma experiences. We can be made to feel like what happened to us was our fault. There is nothing, no how, no way that there is anything that Joseph could have done that would have warranted what happened to him. Amen. 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 Many abuse survivors struggle with shame and guilt as part of their healing. They have to recognize and embrace it was not their fault. Yes. What happened should never have happened, period. It was not about what they did, nor are they to blame. And neither was it Joseph's fault. He was kidnapped, he was stripped down, he was thrown into a pit, he was sold. It was not his fault. Joseph was a victim and a survivor. Joseph and his family were forever impacted and changed by what happened to him. Judith Herman is a psychiatrist and a Harvard professor, and she is known for her work on trauma and recovery. And she's developed a framework outlining stages of trauma recovery. I want to share them with you briefly, and then we'll go through Joseph's story this morning and look at how these stages played out in his life. Dr. Herman suggests that stage one is safety, stage two is remembrance, stage three is mourning, stage four is reconnecting with ordinary life. And her stages are helpful when we consider how God heals, how God meets us and walks with us through the darkness, how he tends those broken hearts and binds up the wounds that we read about in Scripture, how God is present in the darkness of trauma. First stage that she notes is the stage of safety. And safety is essential if people are going to heal. If you feel unsafe or in danger, healing can't even begin. You are in a perpetual flight, fawn, or flee, you know what I mean, stage. Safety is multifaceted. There is embodied safety, which is the literal physical safety. And there is emotional safety and how that presents in our bodies. But there is also environmental safety, which means that I feel safe in my environment. I feel like I have some control over what could happen to me. And all of that safety is essential for healing. When you think about it, it is likely that Joseph was dealing with trauma for a very long time. And that he was re-traumatized because his safety was not secure. Beginning with what his brothers did to him, and then being given to traitors, and then becoming a slave in Egypt, he was subjected to a new place, a new culture, new customs, new ways of doing things, far from his family, far from his spiritual center and connection, and his life was not his own. He was unable to protect himself. He had no control over what happened to him. I had to pause here because from an African American perspective, it sounds very familiar, doesn't it? This was trauma with a capital T. How could he even begin to process what had happened to him? He couldn't begin his journey of deeper healing. He was trying to survive. Because he was not yet safe. And that lasted for a number of years. By the time we get to Genesis 39, we're told that the Lord was with Joseph. And that's so important for this whole narrative. Actually, that comes up four different times where the narrator says, and the Lord was with Joseph. This is one of those times it says the Lord was with Joseph and Joseph began to prosper the house of Potiphar. And he found favor with Potiphar. And one might surmise that in that space he was maybe beginning to feel some degree of safety and stability. He knew the ropes and Potiphar had given him a lot of authority and he was finding his way. And then he's sexually assaulted by Potiphar's wife. He's victimized again. Then he's wrongfully accused. And he's victimized again. We're talking about trauma upon trauma upon trauma. You know, it's interesting to note that so far the narrator of this story in the writing has not mentioned any emotions that Joseph may be feeling. We see that he excels in his role. Even when he's in prison, he is given a role of leadership. But we don't see anything about his emotions. It could be that the narrator did not think that was important to share. That could be. But it also may be telling us something about Joseph's emotional state, that there was a numbness that he was experiencing. One writer said that traumatic events shatter an old normal. It can often create inexpressible suffering in their wake, suffering that is sometimes too hard to express. We don't know if that was Joseph's case, but he definitely had reason for it to be. Trauma upon trauma upon trauma. Until there is safety, healing cannot begin. So family, if we are experiencing trauma, or if we are walking with someone who is experiencing trauma, the priority response for us is to help create a safe space, physically, emotionally, environmentally, so that there is a sense and opportunity for them to feel some sense of control of their lives, so they can take those first steps toward healing. A healing journey where God is indeed present even if they don't see him. A journey where we can offer space and help come assist with a spiritual safety of God's presence. But physical and emotional and environmental safety have to come first. Just like we have to give food to a starving person before they even want to hear about Jesus. We got to start with the most important need, and that is safety. The second stage of trauma recovery is remembrance. And this is where those who have experienced trauma can really begin their healing by processing what happened to them. And the processing comes from telling the story, getting it from inside here and getting it out by naming and telling the story, small T's and large T's of trauma. We don't know if Joseph told his story prior, but we do hear him telling it for the first time in Genesis 40:15 when he is in prison. He has just finished interpreting the cupbearer's dream, if you remember the story. And as he interprets the dream, the dream is positive for the cupbearer. The cupbearer is in prison with him, and interpreting the dream, it becomes evident that the cupbearer will not be executed and he will get to go back and work for Pharaoh. So he will be released soon. And Joseph is interpreting the dream for the cupbearer, Joseph says these words in Exodus 40:15. He says, "And please remember me and do me a favor when things go well for you. Mention me to Pharaoh so he may let me out of this place." And here's where he starts telling his story. "For I was kidnapped from my homeland, the land of the Hebrews, and now I'm here in prison, but I did nothing to deserve it." He is starting to tell his story. He is remembering. He is processing. He is telling his story. We hear more of this remembrance of his story as he continues processing what happens as he gives birth to his two sons in Genesis 41:51. The text says, "During this time, before the first of the famine years, two sons were born to Joseph and his wife Asenath. Joseph named his older son Manasseh, for he said, 'God has made me forget all my troubles and everyone in my father's family. He's processing some things. Joseph named his second son Ephraim, for he said, God has made me fruitful in this land of my grief. Even in the naming of his sons, he's remembering, he's processing, he is coming to terms with what has happened to him. He is telling his story even through the names of his sons. We also hear as part of Joseph's healing and remembrance that he notes where God is in the mix. That God had been present with him in this darkness as he is healing. I mentioned before that the narrator mentions, and God was with Joseph, and God was with Joseph. He says it four times, even though Joseph maybe didn't see it at first. And the truth for us is sometimes as we are walking with people who are experiencing trauma or healing from trauma, we are a gentle witness to what God is doing in their lives even before they can see it. Now, that's not to say that we should say, get over it. God is helping you. That's not what I mean. But we can gently remind, was it a good day today? It was. Thank God. We can be a witness even when they can't. Let's continue with Joseph's journey in stage two. Joseph's remembrance for healing comes full circle when his brothers come to Egypt. Genesis 42, 8 and 9 says this. Although Joseph recognized his brothers, they didn't recognize him. And he remembered the dreams he had about them many years before. And he says to them, you are spies. You have come to see how vulnerable our land has become. I can imagine that when Joseph saw his brothers, he was flooded with all kinds of feelings and probably triggered by seeing them. The fact that he remembered the dream. Yes, he remembered the dream that they were going to bow down, and yes, they are bowing down, but all the memories that went with that dream had to flood back to him. We read in the text that Joseph initially treats them harshly. He accuses them of being spies. As they protest, he puts them in prison for 3 days. Later, he releases them, but demands that they leave and bring their youngest brother back from Egypt, or they will die, he says. And this is often taught and preached that Joseph was testing them to see how they were now, and that could be part of it, but I think it's more than that. I think there's a lot going on here. As I said, Joseph had to be triggered to see his brothers. Just think of how we feel in those situations. When we've had a falling out with someone, or they've hurt us, or we've been pained by them, or worse, and we see them. Joseph had to be triggered. There's hurt, there's anger, there's wanting revenge, as well as looking for any signs of remorse. All those feelings would have been mixed up. As Joseph is on his trauma recovery journey toward healing and his brothers are right before his eyes, he remembers. Remembrance and telling one's story of trauma is essential for our healing. It's a must, as hard as it may be. Otherwise, the traumatic experience gets pushed down further into a deeper darkness. And when it gets pushed down, it oozes out in other ways. It oozes out in our relationships. It oozes out in our behaviors. It oozes out in our addictions. It oozes out in how we communicate. It oozes out in our mental health. We've got to release it. We've got to tell the story. As much as it doesn't feel like it is true, remembering and telling one story really is a gift of darkness. Because it's the path to freedom and healing and wellness. God is present to hear. God is present to heal. And as you remember and tell your story to someone you trust, someone that feels like a safe place for you, God is in the midst. He is with you, helping us to heal. The third stage of trauma recovery is mourning. Once a trauma is named and given voice through remembrance and telling one story, the next step is mourning. This is processing what's happened emotionally and grieving what has been lost. Up until this point in Joseph's story, we have not seen any emotions. But when Joseph's brothers come to Egypt, we know that Joseph has already begun processing and healing. He already has two little boys that reflect his reality. And he enters into this next stage of trauma recovery, of mourning, and now we see tears fall. In Genesis 42, 21, 23, and 24, we see Joseph crying for the first time that we know about when he overhears his brothers. The text reads, "Speaking among themselves, they said, 'Clearly we are being punished because of what we did to Joseph long ago. We saw his anguish when he pleaded for his life, but we wouldn't listen. That's why we're in trouble.'" Man, that hit me. When I was reading that again, even this morning, that hit me. He was pleading for his life, and they walked away. The text says, of course, they didn't know that Joseph understood them because he was speaking through an interpreter. They didn't know who he was. He was, in their eyes, he was an Egyptian leader. And by now, he's dressed in Egyptian garb and has all the customs, and he's using an interpreter. So they don't know that he can understand what they're saying. And he hears every word. It says, of course, they didn't know that Joseph understood them, for he'd been speaking to them through an interpreter. And it says, now he turned away from them and began to weep. The text goes on to say that he chose Simeon to be the one to stay behind, and he sends the others back to Canaan to get their younger brother. And in the passages to follow, we see Joseph's emotions. We see him crying two more times. We see him tear when they finally bring Benjamin and he sees his younger little brother who he hadn't seen in years. And then we see him cry right before he reveals to his brothers who he really is. Time doesn't allow us to go deep into this text, but I would encourage you to read Genesis 45 because Judah speaks this really long plea. Because Joseph says, I want to keep Benjamin. And Judah's like, that can't happen. We can't do that to our father. And he gives this big, long plea and essentially offers himself instead. Keep me, but Benjamin needs to go home to our father. And when Judah gives that big, long speech, it says Joseph could not take it any longer. He dismisses all the attendants, and it says he wept. And the text says he wept so loudly that they could even hear him outside the walls. That's wailing. Through a trauma lens, it's likely that Joseph was crying for a whole lot of reasons. Happy to be reunited with his family. Happy to hear how his brothers had grown. Happy to hear how they had cared for little Benjamin. Maybe even a little jealous that they cared for Benjamin in ways that they never cared for him. mourning the years that was lost with his family, his father, his brothers. I'm sure his tears were a mixture of bitter and sweet. And also the crumbling of the trauma that he experienced and the opening door for forgiveness. His grief is real, and it's part of his healing from the trauma he experienced. Mental health professionals tell us a person recovering from trauma must remember and they must mourn what was lost to truly be able to heal. It might be a loss of innocence, a loss of a relationship, a loss of mobility or health, a loss of what was supposed to have been. I don't know about you, but even though my first marriage ended in divorce, and I believe that was the way that it was to go, I still mourned what should have been, what could have been, even though it was the decision that was the right decision for me at that time. There was still grief. There can be all kinds of losses when trauma occurs, and remembrance and mourning are part of the healing. As we walk with those who have experienced trauma, we can create safe spaces and places for them, and safe places and spaces for them to mourn. And that mourning is just being present to let them grieve. Even if the stuff they're saying is hard for you to hear and you may not even agree with it, let them grieve. Because God is there in the darkness as they mourn. The last stage of trauma recovery is reconnecting with an ordinary life. Research shows 80% of people who go through a traumatic event don't develop long-term symptoms. For some, it might be a few days. For some, it might be a few months. For some, it may be a few years. It depends on the severity of the trauma and how you move through the process. But after the mourning, the old self that trauma has impacted has to become a new self. Joseph has now become a blend of Egyptian and Hebrew. Although he is reunited with his family, he is still now keeping the power that he has as an Egyptian leader. He has an Egyptian wife. He has bicultural children. He's a new person, a different person. And he has connected with his family and reconnected with his Hebrew identity and his spiritual roots. And what's more, he's recognized the gift of trauma as something that God could and had redeemed. God redeemed that trauma. In Genesis 50:20, we hear the passage that we hear so often, passage of forgiveness and redeemed trauma, where Joseph says, "You intended to harm me, but God intended it all for good. He brought me to this position so I could save the lives of many people." Amen. Have you ever noticed how often people who have had a deeply traumatic experience go on to work in organizations or serve in ministries that deal with that very same trauma or related trauma? It's one of the ways that God redeems it. Not that everyone has to do that, but it's one of the ways that God redeems it by giving it meaning and using it for a higher purpose, for something good in the world, to help prevent such trauma perhaps from happening to others. To come alongside those who are hurting and being able to really say, "I've been there. Let's walk together." Trauma redeemed often becomes what's called a survivor's mission. In Joseph's case, Joseph was aware of how God had redeemed his traumatic experience by placing him in the exact place that was needed for the coming famine. All of the ways that God put all of these horrific things together had Joseph in just the spot that God would need him to be. He essentially provided for Egypt, the surrounding nations, and God's people for God's story to continue because of where God placed them and how God used the horrific things that happened to him. Now, brothers and sisters, I want to be clear that redeeming trauma and God causing trauma are not the same thing. I don't believe it was God's will for Joseph to be traumatized. I don't believe it's God's will for abuse to happen or violence to happen. I believe these things break God's heart. I believe it angers God as well. This is not what he wants for the world. This is not what he wants for you or for me. But we live in this broken, sinful, evil world. And while some may say God should have or could have prevented it, the truth is that gets tricky. Because that means that God would have to violate someone's free will, the free will he has given us. As long as we are in this world, free will goes both ways. Free will can be for good, and free will can be for evil. And when evil prevails, for the moment, it prevails, but it breaks God's heart. And when that happens, he comes to us. It's why God wants us to abide with him. It's why we need to be reminded that he walks beside us, that he is present in times of darkness. Because he knows in this world we will have trouble. We will face evil. And sometimes it will look like evil wins. But he also reminds us that he has overcome the world. And he can flip evil on its head and thwart the schemes of the evil one. So that what was planned for evil, God can turn it into something good. And heal us and liberate us and free us in the process. In the meantime, we have to remember that he is present in the darkness. And we have to also remember that that healing journey, that trauma recovery takes time. You know, I told you that the section of Joseph's story that we focused on today was Genesis 37 to Genesis 50, however many chapters that is. You can flip in, you get the beginning and flip, and you're done. But listen to how many years it really took. Joseph, when he was 17, was sold into slavery. 13 years later is when he begins serving Pharaoh. That means for 13 years, he was in that space of unsafety and what am I doing and finding his way. 13 years before he began serving Pharaoh. Well, Potiphar was in there, but you get my point. Then 9 years later is when Joseph is reunited with his brothers. You can do the math. But he didn't take a journey of trauma recovery that went like that. It takes time to heal. It takes time to move through the process. And I just feel that's so important because sometimes I hear us beating ourselves up. I should be further along. This shouldn't be bothering me anymore. And God's grace says, it's all right, you're on a journey. Amen. We're going to get there. Yeah. Keep walking with me. Keep walking with me. And brothers and sisters, he is with us in the darkness with gifts of his presence and his glory. I want to close with this passage that we say often because Jesus quoted it in Luke, but I want you to hear it in Isaiah, and I want you to hear the fullness of this verse, the fullness of God's love, the fullness of how he walks with us, the fullness of how he is present with gifts in the darkness. Hear the word of the Lord. Isaiah said, "The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is upon me, for the Lord has anointed me to bring good news to the poor." And when we hear this mission, we see God's heart. Hear God's heart. He has sent me to comfort the brokenhearted, to proclaim that captives will be released and prisoners will be freed. All trauma things. He sent me to tell those who mourn that the time of the Lord's favor has come, and with it the day of God's anger against their enemies. Friends, God's going to have the last word. Amen. And to all who mourn in Israel, he will give a crown of beauty, the gift for ashes, a joyous blessing instead of mourning, festive praise instead of despair. In their righteousness, they will be like great oaks. We all know what oaks are like, strong and mighty and towering. In their righteousness, they will be like great oaks in the Lord, that the Lord has planted for his glory. Brothers and sisters, God is with us in the darkness. He has gifts for us because of his amazing grace and love. Heavenly Father, as we hold what it is that you are sharing with us, each one of us in our hearts, Lord, we know it is because of your grace and your love. Lord, we know that this world is evil, you told us. But Lord, because of your grace, we thank you that you are present. We thank you for your love. We thank you that you journey with us to healing. We thank you that you will have the last word. And so, Lord, as we listen for what you're saying today, I ask that you would just comfort our hearts if we are feeling troubled, that you would give us the insights that you would have us to hear, that you would teach us how to come alongside those who are experiencing trauma and be your hands and your feet and a safe presence. May we be a healing community as we seek to heal ourselves. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Brothers and sisters, as we stay in this space of gratitude for God's grace, I want to invite you to just prepare your heart as we come to the Lord's table and remember what God did for us. I'm going to invite the deacons to come forward. Family, as we prepare to come around the Lord's table together. You know, when you think about trauma, you have to think about what Jesus did for us. That was trauma. Mental anguish, physical anguish. And in that moment when he took on all of our sins, he had the spiritual anguish of feeling his Father turn away. And he did all of that because of his love for us. So take a few moments and just reflect on God's goodness and love to you.
Grace, love.
Say anything that you feel you want to say to God, and we will
it's not what I deserve.
Eat and drink together in just a moment. Just want to give you some time. Earned,
but daily, grace saves me.
Night that Jesus was betrayed, even just saying that now, the word betrayal, it's hard. The night that he was betrayed, even though he knew that it was going to happen, didn't make it hurt less. He was surrounded around the table with his disciples that he had been bonding and pouring into and loving on for 3 years. He took the bread, and after giving thanks, he broke it. And he said, "This is my body broken for you." They didn't get it and understand it at the time. They didn't get it and understand the trauma he was about to go through. But he did it. He went through it. And his body was broken for you and for me. Let's eat together. And then he took the cup. He said, "This is my blood." It represents a new covenant, a new promise, a new way of being with God. His very spirit through his death resides in us to help us navigate this hard world that we live in. We are never alone. God with us. Of the blood that he shed for us. Let's drink together.
Come on, lift your hands, open up your mouth, and thank God for grace. We give you glory for grace.
You
alone
thank you,
deserve
Lord.
It. So we bless your name.
Thank you, Lord. Take a moment and meditate on his grace. Let's not move too quickly. And just thank God for what he's done for us.
It keeps me. I'm clothed.
All because of his grace. It's undeserved. We continue to mess up every day. And his grace covers us. His grace sustains us. His grace holds us. His grace redeems us. It is all his grace. Father, we thank you for your grace. We thank you for your love. Lord, we ask for your forgiveness when we take it for granted. Lord, Lord, we thank you for your faithfulness and your patience and your kindness toward us, because we know we don't deserve it. And it still boggles our mind, Lord, that you would die for us. And so we just want to pause right now and just say thank you for your love and your grace. We love you, Lord. We would be lost, but for your grace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And amen. 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 Well, family, we are still in, at least for me, I'm just still in that presence of the Lord, so I feel like I want to whisper right now. But let us stand for our benediction. We do have our church vision casting meeting immediately after. We will need a few minutes just to transition and get the documents on the screen and get ready. So we'll take a stretch break if you are going to stay for that vision casting meeting. Otherwise, let's pray together. Heavenly Father, the sweetness of your presence is in this place. It is palpable. And so, Lord, we thank you. We thank you. We thank you for this time that we have spent with you, this time that we have spent with one another. And, Lord, as we leave this place, Lord, I ask that you would just continue to speak to our hearts. Whatever it is that you wanted us to hear this morning, Lord, may it just continue to resonate as the invitation that you have for us. However you want us to respond, may we hear you today. And Lord, as we leave this place, may our light shine bright. Lord, we know this is a hurting and broken world. May we, like Isaiah, go with your message of comfort. May we go with your message of love. May we heal and touch broken hearts through your Spirit, however you lead us. And may our light shine bright for all to see your love, your peace, and your grace. Until we meet again, in Jesus' name, amen and amen. Amen, family. God bless you.